Life Over Coffee. Conversations for Transformation.
Statistically speaking, the chances of your son or daughter being married are greater than them spending their adult lives as singles. This likelihood is not inside information, but public knowledge. Boys like girls and girls like boys, and most boys and girls will tie the knot in holy matrimony. Even though there has been a multi-decade assault on marriage between a man and a woman, and many of our children are choosing not to marry today, and there's part of me that really does not struggle with that, especially if they're going to procreate and create God-rejecting children. But within the Christian community, we understand that God made them male and female, and they are to come together as husband and wife, and they are to procreate, and that is a beautiful thing, and it's something that we hope will happen with all of our children, and again, statistically speaking, and that's going to happen to your child, assuming that you have a child or two. And so how do you prepare your son to be an excellent future husband to a wonderful lady? I want to talk about that for the next few moments. For those of you who have boys, you have little men in your home, how would you prepare that son now, today, as a 3-year-old, as a 10-year-old, to be a future husband to that wonderful lady that he is going to marry? When would you begin? Now, the answers that I have for you may surprise you, though, that you probably have already intuited some of what I'm going to say. Though the idea of marriage is becoming more and more confusing in our culture, it is still a popular notion, especially in the Christian community. Every parent has approximately 2 decades to prepare a son, and also, I mean, this applies to a daughter as well, for the most challenging, rewarding, and extended relational adventure that they will ever experience when they come together as man and woman. We call it marriage. You may not know what your child will do vocationally. I certainly do not know about our children. You may not know where they will live, but you should assume that they will marry someone. Think of the early years of a child's life as training years. It's how you would consider anything that you value. For example, if you want to become an engineer after college, you don't wait until you're old enough to apply for an engineering job downtown. You begin plotting a course that will lead you to the eventual day when you can get the job of your dreams. Well, in that way, in an analogous way, marriage is no different. The problem with marriage is that a child does not have the capacity or the common sense to chart such a course. They don't know how to get there. In fact, when you mention girls to boys at such a young age, yuck! This problem is why there are parents. It's why God gave you children. A child's dad and mom are like life coaches in that sense, who have the responsibility and the opportunity to give a child experience marital training to get him ready for that special day when they will tie the knot. Parents wear many hats. There's about 47 of them to my counting, but perhaps none of them are more significant than that of a trainer, life coach, teacher if you want. To teach or not to teach, that is not the question. You are the parent, and your child will learn how to think and behave based on the equipping that you give him, which starts with how you live your life. That's why I said, I mean, it's not, should I teach my child? No, you are teaching your child. Again, not the question. The question is, what are you teaching your child? They are absorbing us. That's what they do. We affect them. We are a primary shaping influence in our children's lives. You are a living, breathing example that is teaching him something each day of his life, whether we like that or not. Kind of sobering when you think about it. Or, from another perspective, it is a fantastic opportunity to step up to the leadership that parenting calls us to. I recall asking a teenager if he wanted to get married in a few years. This was during a counseling session, and he said, no, kind of like that. Punctuated. I asked him why, and he responded by saying that the dysfunction in his family was so infuriating and frustrating that he would never marry. And though his parents did not train him biblically, they did train him. He absorbed their example. Their poor example unwittingly motivated him to reject the idea of marriage altogether. He may change his mind in the future, and I imagine he will. Honestly, I remember the conversation, but I don't remember the teenager that I was talking to at this point. I kind of wish I do remember him and I could reflect back, or I could see where he's at today. And I would imagine that he's more than likely married today, that he decided not to reject marriage because he met that hot babe, and now it's time to talk about getting married. At that time, though, he didn't want anything to do with marriage. His parents trained an anti-marriage worldview into him because of their marital hostility and familial dysfunction. Regrettably, if he does marry, he will not have the training that he needs to do it well. Nearly all the marriage counseling that I have done involved the parents' adverse shaping effects on their children. The parents were not the cause of any of these children's future marital problems, but they were a significant shaping influence. Even if the adverse impact was from one parent, it only takes one ineffective parent to impact the child's future marriage negatively. Parents rub off on their children. I'm so well aware of this that I do have to guard my heart, and I trust that you do as well. Because you're not the perfect parent, and neither am I. We adversely affect them as we try to redemptively affect them. But because we are fallen and we haven't reached that sanctified state of perfection yet, obviously we're going to be an adverse shaping influence to one degree or another. I mean, parents do rub off. I mean, they are training them. I mean, at least passively they're training them just by being in proximity to each other. One of the best gifts that you can give your child is to go ahead and own it, name it and claim it. Take the bull by the horns by actively exporting a Christ-like example and Jesus-centered instruction to them. For example, I do not recommend waiting for the marriage ceremony to explain the art of husbandry to your son. Husbandry is an old English word. You will see husbandman in the King James Bible, Elizabethan English, and it basically means a gardener, a tiller of the soil. A husband is a gardener. He is taking care of something. He is tending his garden, which happens to be his wife. I like to think of it as the art of husbandry, and I am a husbandman. Well, you don't want to wait till the marriage ceremony. You're talking to your son. It's an hour or two before the wedding. And it's like, hey, I want to give you a quick course on the art of husbandry. Man, that would be too late. If he hasn't learned how to be a husband by that time, well, he will go into rapid OJT mode, on-the-job training. He will learn it during his marriage, and that is really not the time. I mean, it's better than nothing, no doubt. But that is not the time that you want to teach a child, how to be a husband. Your first 10 years with your son, dependent to the interdependent years. I've talked about that in other places, that the child's life is in three stages. There's the dependent stage, which is thereabout from 0 to 2. And then there's the interdependent stage, which is 2 to approximately 22, whenever they leave the home the last time. And then, of course, that is the independent stage where they have limited independence as they live on their own, living under God's authority, of course. And those first 10 years, the dependent from 0 to interdependent, or right in the middle of the interdependent years, those are the best opportunities to teach a son the art of husbandry. As he moves toward the end of the interdependent years from 10 to 20 to 22, and into independent living, a parent's job will be to affirm or to adjust any good or bad habits that he has learned from the first decade of his life. And so again, a child's dependent phase is from 0 to 2. His interdependent phase is from 2 to 22, and his independent phase is, well, whenever he leaves the home to the rest of his life. And so those early years will be your son's most attentive and pliable years. That's when he's paying attention because he doesn't know nothing. And you know, if you had children and they've grown up, well, they've grown into the interdependent stage, and eventually they will know everything. They will be omniscient, where you can't tell them anything. And that's why these early years are the most attentive and pliable. They ask you 1,000 questions. This is where it becomes so annoying. And you may say to yourself, hopefully not aloud, "Will you stop asking me so many questions?" But these are wonderful opportunities because they are attentive and they are pliable. As they move into the teen phase of their life, they will want to distance themselves from you by exploring and experimenting with who he is. He needs to discover himself with minimal parental control. Good luck with that. He's itching to do this. And if you don't give him space and freedom to be who he is, to succeed and fail on his own, it will merely complicate these years, the latter half of the interdependent stage. Your influence will slowly lose its effectiveness. If you have been a positive, intentional, active training influence, he may still want your advice. If you've been a negative, passive trainer or an over-the-top, aggressive, angry trainer, he will resist your efforts to instruct him at this point after he launches into the incremental independent lifestyle. There are many things that you can teach your son about the art of husbandry. Three of those things in sequential order, and I want to talk about them, and that is learning, loving, and leading. All three of these, they flow out of 1 Peter 3:7, the how to be a good husband verse. Fortunately, our son had three women in our home to ply his future trade. Since he was about 3 years old, I told him that how he treats the women in our family would be a snapshot of how he would treat his future wife. And so I wanted him to learn them, to study he studied the women in our home. And the more that he learned them and then hopefully loved them, learning how to love them, and then leading them, then that is good art of husbandry prep for a young child. We knew that our son would not be profoundly different in attitudes and words and actions with his future wife than he was with his sisters and his mother after the honeymoon wears off, of course. If he were selfish now, he will be selfish then. If he were a servant now, he would be a servant then. I wanted him to learn how to make practical applications of the gospel with his sisters and his mother while in the training laboratory, our home. What better time to teach a son how to be a husband than in the laboratory? And if there's a female in the home, a mother or sisters, then, well, the more the merrier. Now, it may not be that way from the son's perspective, but you have a fully functional, stocked laboratory to teach him the art of husbandry. If he could master the practicalized gospel in these relationships, he would be in an excellent position to do marriage well. And that was our thinking. One of those practical data points was serving. Jesus did not come to earth for others to serve him. Jesus came to serve others, and we read that in 10:45 of Mark. If our son could learn this singular aspect of the gospel, just this one snapshot of the gospel, he would be a rock star in his future marriage. And all the women say, all the wives say, amen, that he learns to be a servant. Paul said it another way when he appealed to us to count others more significant than ourselves in Philippians 2:3. And so with learning in mind, in this sequential order of learning, loving, and leading that we see in 1 Peter 3:7, here are a few questions that will help you to assess how well you may be guiding your son. Question number one, how has your son been affected by the gospel? This is an important question because his affection for Christ or the gospel will determine everything that flows from his heart. We can only export what we have. And if we have been affected by the gospel, and one aspect of the gospel is serving, then we will be motivated to serve because we're motivated by the gospel. And so how has your son been affected by the gospel? Number two, is he a gospel-centered learner? Now, I know that as he hits the latter stage, the interdependence stage, and grows in omniscience, he'll be asking fewer questions. But you should have an idea of what he will be like after he crests the peak of omniscience at the later end of the interdependence stage and starts crashing down into the valley of ignorance as he gets older. If he has been a learner prior to his omniscience, he will be a learner after he realizes he doesn't know everything. And so, is he a gospel-centered learner? Number three, how is his affection for the gospel affecting his family relationships? Remember, our children are absorbing us. We are a shaping influence. Well, our children are shaping influences as well. And so how is your son shaping or influence, or affecting other familial relationships, particularly the women in the home? And then finally, number four, does he seek to understand his parents and siblings to serve them? We want to live with them in an understanding way. That's what Peter was saying in 1 Peter 3:7. Well, you can't understand them unless you are a learner. And so is he seeking to understand or to learn his parents, to learn his siblings with the motivation of serving them? The second linkage in this order here is loving. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7 is a part of what we call the love chapter. You know it well as it says, love is patient, love is kind, love does not envy, love does not boast, love is not arrogant, love is not rude. Love does not insist on its own way, love is not irritable, love is not resentful. Love does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. There is a lot there about love. And the call on your son's life is not only to understand the females in his home by learning them, but he must also know what it means to put learning into practice. He must love them. Paul gave us a template for what love looks like in 1 Corinthians 13, as I just read to you. And if you go back and read that passage, I would ask you to note the 15 pieces of evidence of biblical love, and think through how to teach them to your son. And in fact, you could list those 15 pieces of evidence about love. You can list them on a sheet of paper, put them in a column, and put them in a question form, and then just assess your son. You don't have to do this in front of him. I would appeal to you not to do that. But as husband and wife, or if you are a single parent, maybe with another friend, you sit down to life over a coffee, and you work through these 15 pieces of evidence about love in 1 Corinthians 13, the questions would sound like this. Is our son patient? Is our son kind? Does our son envy? Does he boast? Is he arrogant? Is he rude? Does our son insist on his own way? Is he irritable, resentful? And maybe you want to caveat here that what you're looking for are patterns, not episodes, because I would imagine that all of us are impatient, unkind, envy, boast, arrogant, rude, insist on our own way, irritable, and resentful in an episodic way. But you're looking for a characterization, not did he do this today and, you know, three times this month, but is this who he is? Does our son rejoice in wrongdoing? Does our son rejoice in the truth? Does he bear all things, believe all things, meaning does he think the best of others? Does he hope all things? Does he endure all things? I mean, who wants to marry a millionaire? If these concepts are how your son loves others, especially his wife, then he is the millionaire. He is a rich man, a biblically saturated rich man, and his future wife will be overwhelmingly blessed to marry this wealthy man. Your goal is to train these things into your son to the point to where his thoughts, his attitudes, his words, his actions have a love reflex to them. You sneak up behind him and he reflexes in love. That is his impulse. That is his instinct. Now, again, what you're looking for initially is the presence of these traits rather than the perfection of them. I talked earlier about episodic versus a pattern. Well, it will probably be more episodic in the beginning. Another way of saying that is that the presence of them, not consistent. But eventually, you'll see the perfection of them, I trust. If you plant the seeds of these ideas in his little heart, you'll have a decade or so to mature them into a harvest of love. The best approach is to teach him one concept at a time, that you don't overwhelm him or overexpect too much from him. If you laid out these 15 things to him, it would be overpowering to him, to the point that it might exasperate or discourage him, that he'll get lost and just give up. I cannot be those things. You're asking me to be Jesus. I can't be Jesus today, not while I'm a child. I need to grow into this. And so you teach him one at a time. And you'll have many opportunities to observe and to encourage him. And then each time that he nails it, you want to draw attention to what he did. There's evidence here on the floor. There's evidence in the room. There's evidence in your sibling's life that you are not rude, that you did not insist on your own way. And when he nails it, encourage him. Draw attention to what he did. Show him the evidence. Repeat it back to him. This is what you did. This is good. He needs to know what good looks like, what Christ looks like. Motivate him by grace, by identifying and isolating the evidence of God's good work in his life. Affirming words build up and motivate while assuring him that he is doing it right. And so under this category of loving, the first one was learning. Live with them in an understanding way, as Peter says. Well, we want to learn them. We want to understand them so that we can love them. And here's a few questions for love, three of them. Number one, does your son spontaneously serve others? I'm using serve here as the primary category to examine how he's learning. Is he learning to serve? How he's loving? Is he loving by serving others? Does your son spontaneously serve others? Number two, describe how you see his heart of love for others. And does he have manners in that he knows how to honor and show respect? Maybe discretion would be a good word here. Also, does he have these character traits? Now, I would encourage you to get these questions from our website. Let me tell you where they are so you can find them. It's in the article, Teaching Your Son Today to Be a Great Husband Later. You can type great husband later. Just type that phrase in. This article will come up and you can pull these questions out. The four questions that I gave you under loving, the three questions here The four questions under learning and the three questions here under loving. And then in the sequence is leading. Again, he's a man, and so he will be the leader of his home as he follows Christ. And so as the leader of his home within the hierarchy, you want him to learn how to lead well. But remember, leading comes after learning. Learn her so you can love her, and then you begin to lead her. A great leader will take the time to study, to learn his audience, and then seek to serve, to love them based on what he has learned about them. A self-centered person will only think about himself and his desire to do stuff that will be about him and his selfish pleasures. You'll find everything that I've said about loving and the leadership style of Jesus. He became like us in Philippians 2:7 so that he could understand us in Hebrews 4:15, so that he could love us in Hebrews 2, verse 14. There is no more extraordinary model of leadership than Jesus. And if your son learns to emulate the life of Christ by loving us, and leading us, then he will be a fantastic leader husband. And so you can begin your early assessment of him by asking him these three diagnostic questions. Not asking him, asking yourself. Talking with your spouse, or if you're a single parent, talking with someone in the church that knows you and knows your son. But here's three diagnostic questions that are under these sequential linkage here of loving, learning, and leader. I'm going to take them backwards, starting with leader. What kind of leader is your son today? Now, that's an open-ended question for you to really spend time reflecting upon, and I would encourage you just to sit down and think about it, but that's why you want to brainstorm in a small focus group, which would be your spouse or someone in your church who knows you and your son well. But what kind of leader is he today? Number two, learning. Is he more interested in himself or others? Does he mostly study himself or study others? And then number three, loving. Is his love mostly self-centered or other-centered? Now, you should never ask whether your son is a leader. Your son is a leader. In fact, every person, male or female, is a leader. And so the question to ask is about the kind of leader that he is. We all lead. We're all setting an example. We're all setting a pace with our lives. And so rather, it's kind of like asking the worship question. Do you worship? We never ask that question. We ask, what are we worshiping? Because we're born to worship. And because we live in community, we will be influencing other people. Therefore, everybody is a leader to one degree or another. So the question is, what kind of leader is he choosing to be right now? This worldview is why you want to teach him how to practice an others-centered lifestyle. If he chooses a self-centered leadership style, he will perpetuate frustration in his relationship while sucking the life out of his future marriage. Any saved, sane, humble, wise woman would love to follow a man who spends his days counting others more significant than himself, and who knows how to care for her practically. And so I gave you a practical template to teach your son in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. Love is kind, love's not rude, love does not insist on its own way, etc. And it provides a snapshot of the life of Christ, which is why it is so powerful. A good practice is to write down those points as I suggested and do a personal assessment of your son. Identify his strengths and weaknesses. It's such a wonderful template. Discern the kind of person that he is today, right now, regardless of his age. And that will give you the starting point to develop him into a competent future husband. And with your starting point nailed down and Christ in view, you can begin plotting your course that will equip him for the rest of his life. If you are not currently modeling the life that you want him to live, then that is your new starting point. The starting point is not where he is, but it's where you are. It would be hypocritical and disastrous to attempt to teach your son something that you are not trying to perfect in your life. Trying to perfect. I'm not saying that you have perfected it, because neither have I. That would be disingenuous and intellectually dishonest. It's a nice way of saying lying. If I said that I had perfected it, I'm not. He is still working on me, and thankfully he is not done. But the truth is, not have you perfected that template in your life that you see in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 4 through 7, but are you trying to perfect it in your life? If you attempt to bypass the personal modeling of Christ, then he will more than likely reject you and the Christ that you hope that he will emulate. As you do these things, remember that your most powerful parenting tool is prayer. Do your best to train your son, but never forget that if your child transforms, it will be because of God's grace. Awful parents can have God-loving children, and good parents can have Christ-rejecting children. Realizing you're operating under God's sovereignty and mysterious grace, it's not a call for sloppy parenting practices. It should keep you from over-trying, doing too much too hard, controlling too much, manipulating too much. It should also keep you from over-worrying about the results. Leave the results to God. Your job is to water and plant a discipleship worldview into your child. Before addressing your child's strengths and weaknesses, as I ask you to do, if you're able and willing, in 1 Corinthians 13, what are yours? Are there areas that you need to address? If so, what are they? And how do you plan to change them if you need to change, assuming you need to change? If you do need to change something, then please ask somebody, a spouse, a friend, to assist you. Would you work through 1 Corinthians 13, the template, assessing yourself? Perhaps you're unsure of an area where you need to change. Applying those concepts to your attitudes and your words and your actions may spur you on in the right direction. It may be a spur in your side, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. It is a dangerous thing to do, and I think all of us intuitively know that as we think through that list of 15 evidences of God's grace in our life as we read through the love chapter. I mean, we pretty much know how that's going to go. There's going to be a thorn or two that's going to stick us, but it is well worth doing these self-assessments from time to time. Some parents need to repent to their children before initiating something like what I'm asking you to do. You want to be humble. If your parenting has not emulated 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, that standard, I mean, again, not perfectly. If you share your failures and seek forgiveness with your child, it could open a world of opportunity for you to be the leader that he needs to see so that he can follow your example, so that he can learn how to lead today to be a future husband later. If you'd like to read what I just shared with you, go to lifeovercoffee.com. And you're looking for this article, Teaching Your Son Today to Be a Great Husband Later. You can find it at our website. By the way, it's also part of a book that I have for you called The Talk. I'm talking about the sex talk. And in that talk, I build a long runway up to the actual talk. This is one of the chapters in that book that I wanted you to know about, because that's a part of the sex talk. Imagine when you come to the point of the sex talk and you're talking about learning and loving and leading, and then you have the sex talk, all of that woven in together. It is a fuller, a robust, a more comprehensive way of having the sex talk. And if he's had 10 years or 12 years of you incorporating these things in his life, he will be ready to receive the sex talk and to receive it in a context of bibliocentric teaching, training, and modeling from your own life. Now, of course, if you haven't done that, please understand. Some people will hear this and say, I am a million miles from what you're saying, and some will say, it's too late. Well, it's not too late. It's not too late for the grace of God. We don't want to be legalists thinking that our failures is determinative in that because of my failures, my child will never be saved. We don't want to be a legalist like that. No, the grace of God can transcend all of our failures. But if you have the opportunity to be preventative and to get on the front end of it, then I would encourage you to do that. You can do that today. But even if your children are already outside the home, you can go to them and have that conversation with them. And I would pray to that end. But please not only read this article or listen to it or watch it, but get the book in which you find this chapter called The Talk. Go to our store and you can download it. And then, of course, as we require, share it with 1,000 of your closest friends. We want as many people as possible to get this book because it is a valuable teaching tool, especially for parents that want to walk their children through that season of life, or for those of you who are mentoring, discipling others, this book will be a handy tool for you. For those of you who are able to keep our resources free by giving to our ministry, if you can invest, I would appreciate that. It allows us to produce this content and to give it away to the world. And so if you're able to invest one time or monthly or annually, please do that. Help us to keep our resources free. Thank you so much.
Thanks for joining us. Learn more and get access to other resources at lifeovercoffee.com.